passion you guys put. It fucking feeds us, makes us love doing this fucking shit. Thank you. That's all I got. Fucking enjoy yourselves. Everybody, give it up for Mr. Tom Hunting. Come on, make some noise. And everybody, re-invite Rick back to the stage. Come on, let's hear some noise.
How you doing?
I'm good.
Good?
Yeah.
Is it good to be back to do this shit?
Yeah.
You know what they say? You can always go home, right? We got a couple left. What do you say we get the room moving for the last two, huh?
Yeah!
You know what we're gonna play now, come on.
I know what we're...
I can't fool you.
Hey, we gotta dedicate that one to Wainston. You see Wainston yet? Where's Wainston? We got a Wayne from Hatebreed here, I think.
Wayne!
Whenever we get him drunk, you know what? We changed his name from Wayne to Wainstead.
Wainstead.
Where's
so,
Wainstead?
Wayne from Hatebreed is here tonight. Because he's kind of a... He's a Connecticut guy, but he's turning into a Calic guy. So Lee has been getting him drunk backstage all night long. So Wainstead, we still have plans for you, or I'm sure he does. So let's see this room get lit up. I need to see it. Two more songs. Can I count on you, Bay Area? Yeah. All right, then what do you say? Let's all do the Toxic Live!
That's how they do it, baby. You ready?
Are you ready?
I'm ready. Okay. Gentlemen.
Oh, you gotta do that again.
It's to line the vocal up.
Oh.
Just to sync the vocal up is why I do it.
I was all ready to start doing car wash.
No. Great. Nobody's done that before. It's so when we sync the vocal up, because the vocal, it's all different. So, are we ready? Here we go. What's up, everybody, and welcome down to another episode of Zetro's Toxic Vault. And yes, you have asked, and finally, I have delivered, or actually, he delivered. We have Tom Hunting. Yay! In the studio. In the in the vault, finally. I think I've interviewed more people from Rancid than I've interviewed from my own band on the show, but we finally got you in. We had you in a couple of weeks ago doing a live thing with us, which was kind of neat. A lot of fans chimed in, a lot of great comments from that, but I wanted to get you in just like we've done with so many other artists before. This is what we do on The Vault. We kind of find out how the artist ticked and what it all started out, so I'm not going to be any different from you than anybody else. I know kind of how it goes because I know your parents.
Are we going in the way, way back machine?
We're going to when the first time that you heard music and it moved you. You could be 4 years old. It could be 5 years old. Could you be your mom listening? Because I know your mom was into that type of stuff.
Oh, yeah. Mom liked the first record I ever remember holding, and I just bought it again recently, was Joe Cocker, Mad Dogs and Englishmen.
Mad Dogs and Englishmen. Wow, what a great record.
And then I heard, now that I'm older, I know about that there's actually a tour attached to that, and there's like documentaries attached to that tour that he did with like a 20-piece band and kids and dogs and hangers-on and probably drug dealers and shit.
I'm sure.
Mom had records like that, Johnny Cash. She had Santana, Abraxas, and you know.
And you're 45 years old right now, so you're
I'm like
69, 70.
Just
right?
out of diapers, probably, right. You know, checking out these records. And Blood, Sweat, and Tears was another one.
Yeah, my mother loved them.
Three Dog Night, I know your dad liked
them. Yeah, my dad loved them, yeah. I remember.
Thank you.
Live at the so, LA Forum. I remember that record, fucking L Three Dog Night, live
so
at
yeah,
the LA
I mean,
Forum.
You know, we're definitely older people now, like, you know, older people, you know, we got conditions and things going on, but living through that era was amazing, like being a kid.
Talk about, like, what was the thing that grabbed music for you? And what was your first real band that you locked in and said, okay, I don't know, I think I kind of might want to do this? Because, I mean, I know you're Rolling Stones and, you know, you listen to rock and roll like that.
I listened to everything. Like, well, I mean, hard stuff didn't even enter the picture until my brother brought home Animals by Pink Floyd. And that just, up until then, it had just been like, you know, Three Dog Night was the hardest thing that I had ever heard. And when the 70s happened and Pink Floyd and then it, you know, Molly Hatchet and later on New Wave of British Heavy Metal. but I remember being in the crib watching Glenn Campbell's Variety Show. Remember that show?
Yeah, sure. We watched all the Johnny Cash's.
I remember being in a playpen going, I'm going to fucking do that someday.
Really?
You know, I want to play music anyway.
Ladies and gentlemen, the fantastic Johnny Cash!
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around the bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on. But that train keeps rolling on down to San Antonio. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die.
Watch him die.
When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry.
Play, play.
Rich folks eating in a fancy dining car, and they're probably drinking coffee and smoking big cigars. Oh, but John, I had it coming. I know I can't be free. But those people keep moving, and that's what tortures me.
But I don't know, I was always drawn to it or whatever, and you know, growing up in a musical house, I think, helped with that, you know. There was a lot of music programs in the schools, which, you know.
Did you play?
They're starting to bring back more art into the
school. Did you play a musical? Did you play drums? Was that what you played?
I started playing trombone in the fourth grade. And then I played guitar in the sixth grade, seventh grade. But I always had a hankering to want to play drums.
Uh-huh.
And my neighbor down the street, Larry Salucci, sold me my first drum set for $15, and it was an 18, a 12, and a snare drum and a hi hat, and that was it. I was hooked.
And how old were you at this time?
But playing drums in school was different because, like, I'm left-handed, and the kits were always set up right-handed, and the music teacher at first wouldn't let me switch it around to play the other way. So I sucked, and I was like, why am I sucking? I know I can crush this, you know? And finally, I talked him into letting me play the other way. And that, plus some of the earliest drummers I remember, like some funk kids were playing funk music back then, in junior high school, like on this right-handed kit, and I was like, I could do that, but I need to switch the shit around the other way. After that, like, then that's all I wanted to do. I was just fucking...
Uh-huh. And when did you get any lessons at that point?
Never, you said never for drums.
You had bought that kit, and never.
Drums were just like something. I'd go into my bedroom with headphones on, and you know, play Draw the Line or Hold the Line, like for fucking
on that $15
that exact
kit,
song, like
on that $15 kit that you bought or whatever you paid.
Well, no, I got burned by a friend a couple years after that. He sold me a which now would be like probably worth about $1,000, a little jazz Ludwig kit. And I combine that with the old shitty kit, and that's the drum set you hear on the,
and now, how
on
old
the first
are,
Exodus demo.
How old are you at this point, and what grade are you in?
Probably 12, 13. I was heavy into guitar, and then I switched over to drums about 12, 13. Junior high.
Uh-huh.
Eighth grade. Yeah. And seventh grade was
but
spent
not
playing.
Introduced to heavy metal, but still liking music like Aerosmith and Zeppelin.
That came much later. Like, I was more into, like, Motown and, you know, the early stuff that my mom played for us. And she liked country and Hank Williams and all that
right.
shit, too. So, like, that was a whole nother thing that I loved. The outlaw country movement was just amazing. And that's good music to learn how to play drums to, because it's...
Yeah, sure.
Seen the world with a five-piece band.
Yeah.
Looking at the backside of me. You know?
Right.
I got popcorn in my tea.
That's
sorry.
Okay.
Sorry,
you
viewers.
Popcorn. But you got your drink down there, right? You're
all good.
Okay, you're okay. You don't,
anyways,
have to clean, you don't have to clean that out. We
So like the earliest things were, you know, that. And then my peers started turning me on to like AC/DC. And right about that time I met Gary Holt. Like, he didn't even play guitar then.
Right.
When I was playing drums in jazz, a class called Jazz Band at Richmond High, and it was like 79. So like in 79, school was wide open. They had so much art going on. It was just flowing. Everybody could learn any instrument, you know, from level 1 to level 4. And
there were 3 different guitar classes when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
When I was in college, it wasn't just like second period, you got to take guitar then, because that's all there was. There was
that,
3
and
different
that
guitar classes.
That applied to any instrument, dude, like clarinet. Like, how many kids pick up a clarinet nowadays?
Right.
And like,
sure.
It's kind of, I hope it doesn't become like a lost art kind of thing, but I don't think it will. But anyway, we had high school jazz band, and the teacher was really cool. His name was Mr. Davis, and he was like this really like, you know, progressive, wanted to like, wanted the kids to like expand on whatever art they were thinking about kind of teacher. And he created this other class called Rock Band. So that,
really?
So in the
wow, before School of Rock and everything. Wow.
In Richmond High Auditorium, he let us carve out some space in the attic where we jammed. A guy named Tim Agnello played guitar. Eddie Clare, the guy who burned me on the drum set, was on one drum set. I was on the other drum set. It was two drummers and a guitarist. And that was some of the earliest formations. And Tim actually was writing some songs. And
I remember Tim.
Yeah, Tim Agnello.
I remember Tim.
And then, Gary Hull was still like the stoner kid that didn't even play guitar yet.
Uh-huh.
And like, and then I got kicked out of Richmond High because I cut a lot of class and, you know.
Not you.
Smoked a lot of weed. Anyway, but so I got sent to De Anza High School, and then I met Kirk.
Uh-huh.
And Kirk was like, you know, I think we were listening to UFO the first day I'd ever met Kirk, and that was
Strangers in the Night.
That was as mind blowing as just meeting Kirk for the first day, you know. So, and we were just kids, man. I was like
15, right?
15,
yeah.
16, yeah, 15 probably, and he was probably 17. And he turned us on to like early Scorps, Tokyo Tapes. Like,
uh-huh.
I had never been exposed to that shit yet.
Uh-huh.
UFO, and then some other friends in Richmond bought our first Iron Maiden record. So me and Kirk started jamming, and Tim, and we formed a band. We formed Exodus, basically. That was the earliest formations of Exodus. And we toured. We didn't tour, but we did like, actually went camping and did a show in the mountains up at Cobb Mountain.
That's touring back then, boy.
Yeah.
You're on the road.
We played a poolside party and went camping.
The road.
Anyways, yeah, and then we became a trio, and Tim went his own way and did a different band, and Kirk and me and a guy named Jeff Andrews had a three-piece of Exodus going.
And you guys did parties and stuff, too, as
totally.
A three-piece, right?
We did parties as a three-piece. We were playing, like, Iron Maiden, Running Free, and like people in Richmond, California thought that shit was originals by accident.
And you were the singer, right?
Like, nope. Wish I could take credit for that one, but I didn't write it.
And you were the singer, right? Kirk and Jeff didn't sing, did they? It was you were the singer.
I was the singer then. And then we got this guy named Dave Vanderhoof, and he was kind of a Van Halen, David Lee Roth clone, except he couldn't sing, so like he had to go. And honestly, we were locked into more like Angel Witch.
New wave of British kind of, heavy metal.
Yeah, yeah. We were very enthralled with that. We didn't want to fuck with like Van Halen style, you know, music. We didn't want to go that direction. yeah, I mean, and then I met Bailoff. Kirk met Bailoff before I did, and he introduced me to him at a Harry Carey concert, and I think Hans Naughty,
exactly who you're talking about. The emulation was every movement. Hans Naughty was Van Halen. They were the Bay Area Van Halen.
Absolutely. Harry Carey was a great band. But I met Bailoff, and, you know, he was very like-minded about, like, kind of like Kirk and me were about, you know, Iron Maiden, Scorps, UFO. Like, there was a clique of people that were really into that shit. Uh-huh. And then college radio happened, like Rampage Radio. And college radio in general doesn't really get enough credit for the beginnings of what we do. Because, like, honestly, bro, like, some of them early Exodus tours where I was driving the band around in a van because no one else had a license, we would do all of Canada, East Coast, and we would be staying at people's houses that were, like, part of the college radio scene.
Uh-huh.
Because we didn't have any money.
Right.
We were, like, cutting our teeth and fucking paying the dues.
Exodus in the studio. We've got the Exodus demo. Oh, yeah, you know who they are. Oh, yeah, I'll pay a lot. Paul Bailoff, excuse me about that. Paul Bailoff on singer, and you know Gary Holt on guitar. You know they're just jamming away. What do you guys got to say about this raging show? You know, tomorrow night at the Mav. You gonna rage?
Hey, Ron, you're raging too hard, pal. And tomorrow night we're burning the place to the ground.
Oh, that'll be fun to watch.
Yeah,
and the stage will be burnt to cinders.
And we want to tell our friends out there, mainly some guys, some maniacs, that you're getting ready to die, pal. You better be front row, Dave.
Are you ready to do some major headbanging for Exodus?
Bang, you better be ready.
Oh yeah, we got Warlords coming up right now. Anything you got to say about that song? Hey.
Yeah, this song
is what?
Is like brain rotting, crunching metal.
Listen to the bar solo.
And wait till you hear their new song, Impaler. Now here's some Exodus for all you fans. Ah, yeah. Oh, yeah. Good old Exodus. They're in the studio tonight. Oh, yeah. You know they're going to play tonight, tomorrow night at the Mav. It's going to be raging. Oh, yeah. We got the Exodus crowd in here. You know, we just got Paul Bailoff and Gary Holt. Oh, yeah. The main men of old Exodus. What do you have to say about that song? What do you think? Do you think you got better songs than that one? Like, I heard one song called The Impaler.
Impaler.
Isn't it supposed to be great?
Metal for maniacs. Pure.
Oh, I heard it's the best. What do you think? What do you think it sounds like?
It sounds like the most metal you've ever heard. If you don't like it, you should die.
I heard about all the time changes it has. It's just totally raging with guitar
like
all the way.
Combination of about five different diseases.
Listen to
that's what we want to hear. You know, we want to hear all that kind of raging stuff. You know, the best band and best band rap. Oh yeah, you know they rage. Now it's time for a request. Venom,
KUSF, San Francisco.
After this, I talk.
But it's what helped launch this music.
Sure.
Johnny Z knew that.
Yeah, he did.
Him and Marsha, they were fucking licking envelopes and sending tapes off like 19...
Yeah, well, their record store.
Barely 1980, 81.
Yeah, from their record store.
They recognized what they were hearing. There was no internet. There was no way to like point and click and get instant gratification.
Tape trading.
Motherfuckers were working for the music, like to send it to each other.
Yes.
And that's how all of this started.
Yes.
So right on college radio.
Yeah. I want to know how many of you people go out in the streets looking to kick someone's fucking ass. Maybe a couple of posers, you know. Head on down to the local disco and hang out and waste a couple of people. Have a couple of drinks, get wasted. I want to hear it from every single person in here. If you like metal, the heaviest it gets, I want to hear you fucking scream. Hello, Studio 54. You guys are fucking awesome. All right, the song. This next song, it ain't about no goldfish. And it ain't about no tuna fish. And it ain't about no trout. This song is called Piranha.